I'm going to turn things over to Jana Fine, our Youth Services Consultant.
Thank you, Melissa. Happy Friday, everybody. Happy Talk Like a Pirate's Day, which I won't do because mine is terrible, but I'm sure yours is better. And we have some very special guests with us today. We're talking about the future of Florida's children, preventing child abuse and neglect. And I have two fabulous people with me. The first is Zach Gibson, who's our chief child advocate, the director of adoption and child protection. Oh, there it is. The executive office of the governor. And also Nikki Pocock, the chief marketing officer with the Florida Department of Children and Families. Welcome, both of you. I'm very happy to have you here with us today. And I'm going to turn it over to Zach.
Thank you, Jana. Good morning. On behalf of the governor, members of the Florida Children and Youth Cabinet, and members of the Florida Faith-Based Community-Based Advisory Council, we wanted to thank all of you for your work in efforts to provide information and resources to your local communities. We recognize the value of libraries, and we're honored to have meetings of the Children and Youth Cabinet and our Faith-Based Community-Based Advisory Council hosted at libraries in Gainesville and Pensacola this past year. As we schedule meetings throughout the state for 2015, we look forward to reaching out for your consideration to host future meetings. Today's webinar is the first of a series of webinars where we want to provide information and resources on statewide initiatives and campaigns to promote healthy child development. We seek the support of libraries to assist in disseminating information and resources within your libraries to further our collective efforts to raise awareness that promotes education and can prevent children and youth from entering the dependency and delinquency systems. The objectives for today's webinar are how to identify and report child abuse and neglect, providing information on statewide initiatives and free resources and referrals, provide information on National Bullying Awareness Month, and certainly to seek the support of libraries to post and disseminate information. So we'll talk more about that. I'd like to now pass it over to Nikki Pocock to talk about child abuse and neglect and our statewide initiatives.
Hi, everyone. This is Nikki. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you so much for having me. I'm going to kind of go through the different initiatives that we have, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about the issue. You might not realize just how much some of the topics affect children in Florida. And then I'll show you all the free resources and referrals that are available. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is the signs of child abuse and neglect. And these are things that you may see in your libraries. Maybe there are children who come in and who come in regularly and you've seen a sudden decrease in their level of hygiene. Or maybe they're showing some fears, just acting differently. Of course, if there's the bruises and the broken bones, the injuries and that kind of thing, but sometimes it's the regression, the social isolation, the things that you think something is just not right. Let's go to the next one. So recently, actually, it has become law that everyone is a mandatory child abuse reporter. And we say that if you have any suspicion of abuse or neglect, to call the hotline. And, we have people who have master's degrees who answer the hotline calls, and they are counselors who will walk you through, talk about your issues, screen the call, and it's not, sometimes if a case isn't made, maybe it's discovered that this family just needs some assistance. Maybe if the child's hygiene isn't what it should be, did someone in the family lose a job? Have they lost their house? Are they just unable to provide for themselves at this point? Do they need some extra help? And our abuse hotline can offer those resources. And so I do want to encourage you, if in doubt, call the hotline. It's worth it to save that child's life or to offer those services to the family. Are there any questions?
I have a question.
Okay.
The reporter person can be anonymous, or do they need to identify themselves?
Yes, they are anonymous. And there's online and phone reporting available. So I think that was on the last slide. It's got the website address and everything. So Thank you. and there, you can be anonymous on all of them. You can even say to make sure that they mark you as being anonymous. But yes, the calls are anonymous.
Okay. And this is Melissa. We'll be pushing out all of these links and resources in a follow-up message afterwards. So don't feel like you need to furiously write all this stuff down. You'll be getting it soon.
All right, we're moving along. So our first initiative that we're going to talk about is the Who's Really Watching Your Child campaign. Now, this is something that people don't realize a lot of the time, but 25% of our investigations in 2013 involved a non-relative caregiver. So that means a boyfriend, a girlfriend, a friend, just someone who is not related to the child, not the mother, not the father. And to give you, this is just kind of an example. Maybe there's a young mother, and she has, it's especially the children who are under age 5, and, you know, she's working, but she's not really making that much money, she's kind of struggling to get along, single mother, she meets a guy, they have maybe they've known each other for a couple weeks, maybe he's unemployed, and she needs someone to take care of her kids, but she can afford child care, but she's still got to go to work, and so, you know, she leaves her kids with the boyfriend, and maybe he doesn't know how to take care of a child. He doesn't understand that an infant is going to scream and cry, and they have to be fed often, and you got to change their diapers often, and you know, you have to kind of know what's going on with them. If there's a toddler and they're screaming, crying, and throwing temper tantrums, that can be what toddlers do. You know, they might not know how to handle that. Plus, with the stress of not having a job, these not being his children. It's just a lot of factors come into it, and that's kind of a stereotypical situation, but we're trying to combat that with this campaign. Another part of this talks about quality child care. We're encouraging people to not just find child care that's licensed and certified and everyone has their background checks and all that, which is extremely important, but to also make sure that that child has the child care that they need. If there's a preemie who has to go into a child care center, you know, they probably don't need to be in a large facility that has 20 kids in the classroom. And you know, maybe a home setting would be better for them. So it's kind of educating parents and their supporters, their influencers, as to what that child really needs. So this is some of the artwork from the campaign that we have, just to kind of show you some visuals. So we have the one that talks about know the background and parenting skills. Just make sure that they know how to take care of a child. This also goes for grandparents who I know are related to the child, but it can be that, you know, the safe sleep, you know, that we encourage people to put their kids back to sleep, but several years ago, we put their babies on their stomach. There's some toys and things like that that we've discovered are not safe now, but they were fine previously. So it's kind of making sure that they're not only great caregivers but and with well intentions, but also have the most updated knowledge. And then some people, they just get in over their heads, and we want them to know that help is available. You'll see that 211 is listed on the bottom, and they partner with us on several of our campaigns, and they are really a one-stop shop for everything. And not only do we encourage families to contact us to find multiple services in their area, and all of the information that we have, they have as well. So whether it's parenting classes in their area, Healthy Families, Healthy Start, if there's something at the YMCA that would help them, at something at a church, there's a food bank. But we also encourage professionals. So if a child care professional has a child in their class that they're just not really sure how to handle, maybe this child has been the victim of sexual abuse or something like that, or just abuse or neglect in general, and the case is already processed. Maybe they're in foster care or something. But there are triggers that this child, you know, may cower in a corner or may lash out and bite someone, and they just don't know how to handle it. 211 has the resources to hook them up with people who can help them. So it's not just the general public, but also professionals. Let's go to the next one. And so these are where the resources are available. Of course, if a child is in danger, definitely call the hotline, or if it's immediate, you call 911. I want to put that out there first. And I talked about the 211. The Early Learning Coalition is they're local. They have one that covers every single county. They help with child care. Some of them, depending if you qualify, offer subsidized child care. And they also can just help in finding one that's right for a particular child. There's Head Start, there's Healthy Families, there's Healthy Start, there's so many programs out there. And by calling 211, again, you can find all of them or contact them directly. And those may be great partners for in your local area if there are additional resources you want or presentations or meetings. You know, those local organizations are really wonderful. The website that we have, if you go to the DCF website, myflfamilies.com, we have a lot of resources on there. There's a slider up there that kind of rotates the campaigns through, so it's easier to just kind of send you there instead of the direct link. And you'll find lots of free resources there. We have a parenting guide that we put together, and it's available in hard copy, but we find that people like it best in the ebook format that we have. So, it's downloadable, for Kindle or iPad or whatever. It has an interactive menu that you click on, and there's also a PDF format. So if you go in there and you want to print out sections, it's by age group all the way from pregnancy through high school. It has lots of different information. You can print out sections that kind of serve as one-pagers, and a lot of our pediatrician offices do that. And on that site, we also have some videos. If you have TVs or something like that in your libraries, there's downloadable links on that. More than welcome to use any of these materials. There's also printable materials. We have, if you're interested in getting some cards and posters that have already been printed, please let me know, and we'll hook you up with our local DCF office who will have them. But also, there are 8.5 by 11 print-offs that you can just print off on your regular office computer. So now we're going to talk about the parenting programs that we have as a part of this. And our goal with DCF is to take successful programs and highlight them and then make those resources available throughout the state. So on that same website, we have, like it shows here, free curriculums, handouts, everything. So maybe your library or an organization in your area who uses your library has a parenting program, even if it's the reading corners that you have in the morning. I have a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old, and we frequent the library story times, so we love those. So glad that you put those on. So if there's something that maybe you want to cover in that, there are free curriculums, there's videos, again, the handouts, and we also have a list of the parenting programs around the state. There's a database in there, so if you have one at your library, whether it's one that you do or one that some of your partners do, we would love to be able to put those on, so please contact me. And I know my contact information is at the end, but then also I think you guys are going to send it out. Are we at the questions slide? Yep, any questions?
Waiting for anyone who might want to put something in chat. I did have a question. You mentioned that you had the parenting guide.
Yes.
Are those age characteristics like your 1-year-old, your newborn?
Yes.
Those kinds of things?
Mm-hmm. They're developmental. They're listed by age. Yes, a lot of developmental information. And so, for example, for the pregnancy part, it talks about making sure that you talk to your doctor. I know it has a whole bunch of tips in it, like for the baby. So sleeping, how to get them to go to sleep, soothing techniques. There's information about food and nutrition, things to look out for when to take them to the pediatrician, all the way up to how to talk to your teenager about the birds and the bees, bullying and all of that, and drugs and all that kind of stuff. So it tries to go the whole gamut. But it also has things in there like how to get fathers involved in parenting and all of that kind of stuff, which we know there are fabulous fathers out there, but for those who might need a little bit of help, there's that information as well.
And do you have resources of connections that libraries, if they wanted to do like a new parent guide to handling your baby or things of that nature, that they could offer in the library? Are there contacts that they could call 211 and find out?
211 would be good to see kind of what parenting programs are in your area, or you can go to our website because there's a list of them. And the contact information is on there, so of course feel free to call any of those organizations. But there are some handouts and curriculum and videos and things like that from programs that have already been started. So those are things that they can use in any kind of program that they'd like as well to customize it for themselves. But yes, all those contacts are there too.
We do have a question. So www.myfamilies.com is the main website for us to head to?
Yes, that is the main DCF website. And the actual direct link for that campaign is myflfamilies.com/who's watching. But if you go to that main website, myfulfamilies.com, you will find a rotating slider that highlights every single campaign that I'll be talking about today.
Okay, we've got a comment. I was at an event where a representative with the state had a table with a rear view mirror hanger which read, check the back seat. I'm interested in acquiring these for my library. Are these available to organizations that request them, or can I find out where the state purchased them?
We are actually going to do another order of those with a similar message, but it's going to be a little bit different. Definitely for the hot cars, we think it'll be a little bit more effective, but we liked the hangers themselves. The format of them has been helpful. We're also looking at doing some window planes that might be good for cars or for businesses to put on the front, you know, their door when you go to, so that will be great for libraries and things like that. Right now, we don't have additional funding, and we're all out of the hangers and everything, but we do hope to be able to get some more, and we can let you know as soon as we have those in. Okay. There is also, should I skip ahead to the hot car section?
We're going to get to the section on hot cars shortly. I think the question is, do they contact you to acquire those things?
Yes. So for all these materials, if you want any kind of printables, contact me. And even if we don't have any in, it's good to contact me anyways because I keep track of that. So when people come to me and say, well, why do you need us to do another print run? I say, because I have all these people who are asking for them. So it's very good to ask me. And we do have some additional resources, like I was talking about the print-offs that you can just do on your office computer that are on the website. And I'll talk about this a little bit later.
And there's a comment, www.families.com/who's watching appears to be a site under construction. Or do you guys?
Thank you for telling me that. I will look into it. It was working this morning, but I will definitely check. Did you, don't put the apostrophe on the before the S. Make sure that that's not in there. And it's myflfamilies.com/who's watching. But I will definitely look into it.
Okay.
I think
we're good. Okay, so now we're going to go into water safety. So as you can guess, there's a lot of drowning incidents around the state. We're surrounded by water. There are pools everywhere. But it's not even just at the beach or at the pool. It's, it can be just a couple inches of water. It could be in a bucket. It could be in a drainage ditch. Anything like that. It's so important to be vigilant about watching the children. And we'll get to the rules of water safety in a couple minutes. But I wanted to give you some stats. In 2013, so last year, 79 calls of drownings came into the Florida Abuse Hotline. That's a huge number. Drowning is one of, like you see, it's one of the highest reasons that children, that we have child deaths in Florida. Just so far in 2014, 58 calls have come in. It's horrible. These are all preventable deaths. So that, definitely something, if people don't realize what a danger it is. And it's definitely something to be aware of. So here are the rules of water safety. One of the big ones is eyes on the kids. So that talks about supervision. And yes, you want to make sure, of course, that you're not letting your kids get out and, get out the door by accident and go into the pool, which happens because it only takes a couple seconds. Drowning is a silent death. You don't hear anything. And kids, especially the toddlers, they're so fast. You turn around for a second, you put in a load of laundry, you answer the phone, you go check on another child in another room, and they're gone. So, definitely that part of the supervision. But also at pool parties or at the beach or something like that, you might have 20 adults around the pool. And kids are swimming, but nobody's really paying attention to the kids. Everyone thinks someone else is watching all the kids. And again, it's silent. So you may have a child 3 feet in front of you be drowning, and you're looking at your phone or you're talking to someone, and it's just, it's terrifying. So definitely eyes on the kids is a huge thing to remember. Swimming lessons, that's, if something does happen, you want the kids to know how to swim. Even if it's a baby who learns how to float, you just want to make sure that they have that extra layer of protection. The next thing is barriers, and that talks about window alarms, door alarms, and the self-latching fences that should be around pools. And these are actually in law that you have to have the fence around, the self-latching. There's so many things that happen. And it's not even just the children who may be in the house. Maybe it's a next door neighbor who wanders over. Just talking about this, you know, it's very, very sad. So barriers are definitely very important. And then the last line of defense is emergency preparedness. So, if something does happen, no CPR. Have a phone near you, although don't be checking Facebook on it. Don't look at it. Don't talk on it. Let something happen so you're able to call 911 and not have to run into the house to get the phone before you can do it. But learning the CPR is so important. All right, let's go to the next one. So here's some of the artwork for this campaign. So you see the eyes on the kids, be prepared to save a life is emergency preparedness, and the swimming lessons. There's the website down there, that direct link. You can also get to it from the homepage, myfamilies.com. And so we talked about the eyes on the kids. With CPR, and actually let's go to the next page because that shows all the resources. There's the website again. Again, 2-in-1 is a huge resource. The American Heart Association, the YMCA's, the Red Cross, they all offer free or reduced cost swimming lessons. And you have to qualify, but even the YMCA has told me, we will not turn anyone away. We're not going to say that we're not going to teach your child a life-saving skill because you can't afford it. So, of course, you know, it's up to their resources, but they will find a way to make it work. So it's just very important that information is on our website, but then also by calling 211. And there are also videos and everything on that site as well. And then each of those images that we have made 8.5 by 11 printable that you can print off just, again, on your office computer. Any questions about that one?
Did you mention you're going to be talking about CPR?
Oh, sorry. Very good point. So the CPR classes are also kind of the same boat as the swimming lessons. So the Red Cross and the American Heart Association, the YMCA may offer those classes at their facility, and so they all try to make it available to everyone. And they even have some, there are some programs where you can take home, it's like a blow-up dummy that, they're stressing just the heart compressions now and not the mouth-to-mouth. And you can take this, and it's like a balloon, you take it home, and it's got an instructional video, they've got a handbook, and all this stuff, it's just a little package, just a little box. So there are lots of different ways to learn CPR.
I personally think that every library employee needs to know how to do that, no matter what. And I remember when I used to be in public service, we had the fire department, the paramedics come out, and they taught the staff how to do CPR.
And that's another good point. You can contact your local EMT or fire department, police station, and they may be able to offer a course for your employees as well, yeah, or for the community in general.
Right.
A lot of them will have CPR events where they'll do mass trainings.
Not unlike mass weddings, that'd be kind of scary.
Right. So the next one that we're going to talk about is safe sleep. This one is extremely sad. It is one of the highest causes of child deaths in Florida. And here's some stats on it. So in 2013, we had 101 calls come into the hotline about it. Just so far in 2014, we've had 30. And these deaths are 100% preventable. So let's go over to the next slide and we'll talk about each part of it. So there's a part where you want them to be alone, and so that kind of goes into the co-sleeping part. I want to stress that that's not the only part of safe sleep, and we'll get into the other things in a minute. But something to keep in mind is that when parents are sleep deprived, it's almost like being drugged. It's you're so, so tired. And maybe if you're taking a Benadryl or if you're an Ambien or anything like that, it can affect how attentive you are. But in general, though, a lot of the mattresses these days are pillow top. And so essentially you're putting your baby on a massive pillow. And with other siblings, just other family members in general, on the couch, unfortunately, we get some of these. Maybe it's a babysitter or even the parents themselves, but you're so tired and you may even fall asleep by accident. But, try to have some kind of safeguard, have someone with you or have an alarm or something to try not to fall asleep. If you do feel so sleepy, put the baby down. So that's one thing that we're stressing. On their backs, this is something I mentioned before, that this is what we're encouraging now, that we're finding that this has saved. It significantly decreased the number of child deaths related to unsafe sleep. And then in a crib, we actually do recommend that the baby stay in the parent's room or the caregiver's room for the first several months, but just not in the bed. So in a crib near the bed, in a pack and plate, those are great. Just want it to be in a crib. And I'm going to go back to alone real quick, because that, not in addition to being alone and not having people in the bed, but also pillows, blankets, bumper pads are a very big thing. Stuffed animals, it could be the boppy pillows for breastfeeding. Some people might put them in the crib, because the cribs are a lot bigger than babies when they're that small. It's just not worth it. Don't put them in there. Don't prop them up on the boppy pillows. For the bumper pads, I have a very sad story about this one. The baby survived, so I'll put that out there first. But there was a mom, and she had three children. So this is about her, the youngest. And she used the same bumper pads and same bed set with all of her children, had no problem with the first two. So she's watching an FSU football game with her husband, just in the living room. The rest of the house is quiet. It's just their family. All of a sudden, she hears some gurgling over the monitor. And babies gurgle all the time. They wake up, they cry for 2 seconds, they go back to sleep. It's, babies do that. But she got up and checked on the baby, see what's going on. The baby had the ties from the bumper pad wrapped around her neck. And she was turning blue. And the ties were so tight that she was screaming for her husband to get the scissors because she couldn't get them undone. And the baby was fine. Everything turned out okay. But the bumper pads, it could be the ribbons or the string. It could be, the suffocation by getting their heads in between. But again, is it worth the risk? So that's kind of the message that we're trying to get out with that one. And here is the image that we use for this campaign. A lot of pediatrician offices have this up. So if you have young children or have been to a pediatrician office, you may have seen it. We're trying to get those out all over the place. And this is where all the materials are located. And again, you can just go to the home page and slide through that banner if you want to just go there. We've got the printables again. We might have some of the hard copies already printed off. If you contact me, I can see if a region has some. There's also videos, again, on that one. And it also has some referrals, whether it's the Healthy Start or Healthy Families, if people need pack and plays. We're also asking for donations of pack and plays, and those go to Healthy Start and our Child Protective Investigators. So if a community wants to do a drive to raise money, and we can accept money, so you would raise money and then purchase pack and plays yourself, do a drive to have people bring in theirs or bring in some. So that's something that's on there as well. But
I'm not a mother, so I couldn't, and I've been dealing with teenagers primarily, so I don't know what a pack and play is.
Oh, a pack and play. Okay, so a pack and play is like a portable crib. Maybe a play yard, I guess some people might know it as that. So it's not like a play pen, but I guess maybe it kind of looks like that. It has two different levels. There's one level that's a little bit higher for the bassinet when the babies are really little. And then you take that level out, and there's a deeper layer that looks, then it looks almost like a playpen. It's at the very bottom. So, and there are different levels of it. There are some that are just strictly the basics, just that bottom level. There are some that are so bells and whistles that they vibrate and play music and have diaper changing tables and all kinds of stuff. So, but all of them are wonderful, and all of them are helpful.
Thank you.
Any questions on that? Now we're going to talk about Born Drug Free Florida. This is a campaign I'm very excited about. Even though it's a horrible topic, we've actually made a lot of progress with it. So 7 out of every 1,000 babies were born with experiencing drug withdrawal. So these are babies who are exposed to drugs in the womb. And I want to stress that this is not always people who are on meth out on the street or, addicted to heroin, all that kind of stuff, which does happen. But a lot of times we see that these are mothers who are on Ambien or painkiller or antidepressant medication legally prescribed by a doctor. They didn't think to tell their OB about it. So They're from, you know, they care about their baby. They're from, they have a wonderful background and support group. And their babies are born going through drug withdrawal just like an adult does, the same symptoms. They have seizures. They're in severe pain, sensitivity to light. The babies just scream incessantly all the time. They're going through drug withdrawal. The nurses have to give them morphine and sometimes even methadone to be able to ease them off of the drugs. And the mothers are horrified because they didn't want this for their child. They were following doctor's instructions, but you just got to connect. And so we also want to stress that the mother should not stop their medications cold turkey because that also can hurt the child. So we encourage them to get treatment and work with a physician to decide how they're going to handle it. And this is the image for this campaign. And it launched at the end of 2012, so it's been around for a little while. And we did a big paid media push when it first opened. There were billboards, there were PSAs, everything was out there. We have since run out of funding for that, but we hope to do another push soon. And so I hope that maybe you have seen this. All of our OBs have posters and things like that in their offices. But here's the artwork for it. And here's where all the resources are. This was a partnership with the Department of Health and the Attorney General's office. And so there's the website for it. There's materials, there's printables, there's web banners on there, there's radio ads, there's tons of PSAs in all different kinds of formats. They're very powerful. But one of the great things that we have with this one is that we have a helpline. So women, influencers, anyone can call the helpline. You're not reporting someone, you're looking for help. They have a counselor who will talk through the situation with you and refer you to a local place that can offer you assistance based on your situation. Just from October 2013 through July 2014, more than 200 women entered treatment because of this helpline. Not just people who have called, but women who have stepped foot in a treatment center. So, you know, those are babies who... that maybe, you know, it just takes one day of suffering off of their lives, 1 hour of suffering off of their lives. It's worth it. Any questions on that one?
I have, it's not a question, it's a statement of amazement, the fact that when you see the ads about children that are born that are addicted, you automatically assume it's the dangerous drugs, you know. You don't ever think about this prescription drugs.
Right. And prescription drugs,
and it's amazing to me that people, I would have thought that your doctor would have said you have to go off of these before you get pregnant.
But a lot of times there's not that communication. So sometimes when you go to a doctor, maybe you only see them once a year, depending on what the medication is, or maybe you see them every 6 months. So if you go to see them and you get the prescription, you're not pregnant, you get pregnant within that time. You go to your OB, your OB asks, oh, you know, what medications are you taking? Maybe you don't think to mention this drug that you're on because the doctor prescribed it. Well, of course it's okay. They may not think that this could affect my pregnancy. So, well, it's just, you know, the miscommunication, misunderstanding, but unfortunately it has severe implications for the babies.
And is this part of something where newbie parents go through training before the child is born? Is this something that's ever talked about with it?
After the baby is born?
No.
Or before? I mean, it's a part of some parenting classes, but I'm not sure of a percentage or anything like that, but I think it's a wonderful thing to talk about. If you do have parenting classes in your library, know of any in the community, you know, these resources are available.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. So now we're getting to the look before you left. This is the hot cars. And as you saw in the news, there were a lot of stories out this year, and especially with that horrible case in Georgia. So, but it brought it into the national spotlight, and we're happy that people are aware of it. There are two components of awareness for this. Is one, for the parents or caregivers to know, you know, of course, don't leave your child in the car, but then two, for bystanders to know that, you know, to call 911 to help the child. If you see something, say something. And with just 10 minutes, the temperature of the car can rise 20 degrees. And that, so if it's 75 degrees outside, it's still very dangerous. And especially in Florida, and in certain areas of the state, it doesn't get cold hardly at all. So this is a year-round issue. And also, because the child's temperature rises so much faster, even if you saw those videos of the adults sitting in the car and sweating and all that, I mean, the kid would have been hotter a lot faster, five times faster. And people ask, how can you forget your child in the car? It's your child, you know? Are they talking in the back seat? Are they crying? Are they doing this or whatever? How can you forget your kid? But it's as simple, and this is not an excuse for it, but to kind of give you an example. If you're driving down the road and normally you go one direction and you're going somewhere else, run an errand on the way to work, and you just pass that turn, you get on autopilot and you just don't remember. And then, you know, you might get to your work and say, oh, I meant to go somewhere else. But that's kind of, you know, what might happen. We encourage people to set an alarm or put your shoe in the back seat, put a teddy bear in the front seat, put your purse in the back seat, something like that. It also can happen, especially if it's a caregiver who doesn't normally drop the child off. I'll give you an example. I went out of town a couple days, and my husband, I usually drop one kid off, he drops the other kid off, and so we had to drop off both of them. And I was like, you have to call me every single time that you drop off, you know, the child that he usually didn't drop off. And he's like, oh, there's no way I'm going to leave the kid in the car. It'll be fine. It'll be fine. And I was like, no way. I care about these too much. So I set an alarm on his phone to go off. I set it for 10 minutes before he would get to work. So that, because that's the other thing, is it only takes a couple of minutes. So even if I were to call him an hour afterwards, it would be too late. And then so let's go to the next one. I'll show you. This is some of the artwork that we have for it. There was also the hangers, and then so we're going to try to, you know, just kind of alter those a little bit. And again, you know, we'll make those available. Hopefully the window cleans as well. We're waiting on funding. But on the website, I think, oh, go to the next one. Let's see. That has a little website listed. So there's the website. And they do have 8.5 by 11 printables there as well. So in the meantime, if you'd like that. And the images that you're seeing for all these campaigns are also on those websites. If you have, you know, some kind of slideshow or something that you do on a TV, or if you're doing a presentation, you know, feel free to use those images on anything that you have as well.
And if they use the images, they need to credit y'all?
I mean, really, we just want the information out there. So you can just put it up as is. I don't care if they put their logo on it, somebody else's logo, 20 other logos. Take our logo off. We just want the information out there. So, you know, get it out any way you can. I will say one thing, that if you do use these materials, it would be great if you would let us know. It's not a requirement. I mean, if that's going to deter you from using them, you know, just I would rather you get them out there. But it's helpful for us when we meet with the secretary or they meet with the governor and things like that. We're able to kind of plug that assistance and those partnerships that we've made. So something to just kind of keep in mind. I'm not saying send me a formal report or anything, but just something to consider.
And if you can't get a hold of Nikki or Zach, please let us know too, because we can transmit that information. And I would be really interested to see how we can fit all of these really important issues that deal with children into the library in some form or fashion.
We've been talking about with the swim safety, going back to that real quick, trying to target the children a little bit more on that. And so I know that you have a lot of programs that really are tailored to communicate with the child, since a lot of this kind of focuses on communicating with the caregiver. But any ideas for how to communicate with the children, whether it's a puppet show or a presentation, or, I don't know, something, some kind of
story time. There are story times on swimming.
Right, like arts and crafts or something, you know, something like that. We'd be really interested to hear, because another reason why it's great to tell us what you're doing is that if you have an idea that hasn't been done before, or you have an easier way to do it or something, we can take that statewide and make that information available to everyone, so in the hopes that maybe they could implement it as well.
I have an idea in my head that I will mention. There's a great series of books are by Jonathan London, which are picture books. And it's about Froggy. I don't know if you've ever seen those.
I've heard about Stewie the Duck. I think that a couple years ago we did one of those.
Okay.
There was one about a seal, too, that I've seen.
Froggy Gets Dressed was the first one.
Okay.
By Jonathan London. But the illustrator, Frank Brimkowitz, lives in Florida. And they've done a whole slew of picture books, and there's one about swimming.
Okay. That's really good to know.
Really cute.
We can try to help with that. Wonderful. Thank you. Can you go to the next one? So this is something, you know, people, you hear about all these tragic things and people think, oh, it's not happening in my community. Well, unfortunately, it's happening everywhere. So this website that we have, again, on the DCF website, it shows statewide and then also locally what's going on in your area. And, I mean, you know, check it out and just see where are the crises in your area. Is there something maybe that you should focus on more than something else? Just, you know, to kind of see this is what's out there. This is the pinwheel down there. It says prevention. That also links to all of these campaigns. So if you want a different way to get there, there's that way as well. Any questions?
That's a lot of stuff.
I know. That's a lot of information. So kind of digest it a little bit. Feel free to reach out to me again. If you have any suggestions for different components of the campaign or anything, we are always changing these campaigns, always updating them, always doing different angles and spreading new information. So please let us know.
Do y'all have links to the public libraries on DCF's website?
I don't know if we do.
It might be something to communicate between the two organizations.
That would be great. We'll be sure to do that.
Nikki, thank you so much. This is Zach. Thank you so much for that information, Nikki. I think a lot of great information, and certainly the hope is to seek the support of our libraries to assist in posting and disseminating information. I think, you know, with the materials that are available that are reproducible, if you have video monitors to scroll information on these initiatives, we would be so appreciative of your support to do those type of things. The topic I'm going to speak about is regarding National Bullying Awareness Month. Many of you may be aware of this already. It is in the month of October where we're ramping up to kick off a big statewide awareness campaign. The Florida Children and Youth Cabinet identified bullying as a work group, and I wanted to kind of give some perspective about the Children and Youth Cabinet. This cabinet is made up of secretaries and directors from agencies that focus on children and youth in our state, and that they include the Agency for Healthcare Administration, the Agency for Persons with Disabilities, the Department of Children and Families, Department of Education, Department of Health, Juvenile Justice, the Governor's Office of Adoption and Child Protection, Guardian Ad Litem, and the Office of Early Learning. So those are the state agencies that are a part of this cabinet. Additionally, we have five governor appointees representing children and youth advocacy organizations that sit on the cabinet. And then we have ex officio members that are leaders or their designees from state government bodies, to include the Attorney General, the Chief Financial Officer, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, the Senate President, and the Speaker of the House. So a pretty powerful group of folks that come together to look at issues surrounding our state as it relates to children and youth, and identifying opportunities to fulfill its mission of interdepartmental collaboration that can improve the outcomes for children and youth. So again, when the cabinet was identifying issues affecting our state, we recognized that efforts to end bullying and cyberbullying can improve character of individuals and work to strengthen communities and families. To further increase awareness of this issue, the cabinet is working with school districts and communities throughout the state to raise awareness. And I'm going to be talking more about that. The next slide talks about provides you with some statistics. Those statistics came from two sources. The first one is the 2013 Florida Youth Risk Behavior Survey, as well as the 2013 Florida Youth Substance Abuse Survey. Links for that information will be provided after the webinar today so that you can go in and take a look at that. But as you can see, bullying is an issue in our schools, in communities, and more work needs to be done to raise awareness that we can end bullying as well as cyberbullying. When we think of signs of that a child is being bullied, those could include unexplainable injuries, lost or destroyed clothing, books, electronics, jewelry, feeling sick or faking illnesses, changing eating habits, avoiding social situations, and feeling helplessness or decreased self-esteem. As we talked about before, A lot of kids probably come through your libraries, and as you are observing children, here are some signs that, you know, can maybe provide some insight of whether or not a child may be bullied or even experience abuse or neglect. We are working right now to prepare materials, printed materials, posters that we would like to forward to you all for consideration of printing and disseminating throughout the libraries as well as within your communities. Another idea that we are continually exploring is a Twitter town hall. We in our cabinet have a Florida Youth Commission, which are representative of youth throughout our state, and we invite the youth commission, one youth commissioner, to participate in each of our cabinet meetings. But this is a topic through this Twitter town hall that we are working to engage our youth commission to be a part of and have a larger statewide conversation on the topic of bullying and to talk about what we can do statewide as well as within local communities to address bullying and end bullying within our schools and within our communities. The last slide that we have there, there's the statistics right there. I thought I didn't have them, but there they are. If you go to the next slide, we have information and resources that can be found on the Department of Education's website. They've got a pretty robust list of information and resources available. Certainly, as librarians, we know that you guys are information gatherers. If you are aware of any additional resources or materials that may not be found on this website, we would certainly welcome you sharing those so that we can look to consider putting those on the department's website. Ms. Brooks Rumenek is the director of the Office of Safe Schools within the department. She's a great resource, and should you have any questions, she is a great point of contact that can assist you with any questions you may have. With that being said, any questions regarding Bullying Awareness Month? Again, we are working to get materials prepared so that we can not only provide them on our websites, but also to disseminate them statewide. So please be on the lookout for that, as well as information on this Twitter town hall. I think it's going to be very interesting. And we are, again, working very hard to coordinate our efforts to make a positive event occur.
I think that there's probably some libraries that have up-to-date bibliographies about books for youth that deal with the topic of bullying, because there's much more out there today than there used to be.
Absolutely. I think storytelling is a great way to create awareness and education regarding how to address incidents of bullying and how to deal with bulliers. The issue of bullying is really it's a tragic one. Many of us probably have seen, there's been some recent articles of children unfortunately committing suicide as a result of bullying. I read one yesterday about an incident in Jacksonville. Certainly last year there were all kind of articles unfortunately talking about bullying, and you know, it's something that we know happens. We know that sometimes we are even probably a part of it just by being bystanders. And I think when we think of the things that we can do, we all have the ability to use our voices and our actions to support those who are being bullied and to ensure that we work to a more cohesive environment. Any other comments or questions people may have? Well, we wanted to thank you very much for your support today and allowing us to be a part of your webinar, to thank Jana and Melissa for their support.
Thank you.
This is an exciting time for us as an opportunity to really work closely with you all within the public libraries. I mean, you guys are throughout the state and see so many people coming in and out of your doors on a daily basis that, you know, we felt that this would be a great tie-in to the work that we're doing, and certainly want to see how we can also further support the efforts that you all do at the local level. And again, thank you very much for all your support.
Thank you. We have some... more, we have, this is the first of a number of webinars that we're planning on different topics, as well as just some mention of some of the other webinars that we have coming up. Next month in October, we have one of our Future of Florida's Children series that will be dealing with
National
Adoption Month coming up in November, as well as Jose Sanchez from the National Mile High, High Mile?
The Magnetic Lab.
Thank you. The Magnetic Lab, to shorten it, we'll be talking about the mysteries of science. And in November, we have our series will be in December. But we have Allison Scheffler Murphy from the, Allison, I can't remember your title, but she is the director of Poetry Out Loud competition, statewide competition, which is actually a national competition. Well, that's really exciting. So we have a lot of things lined up for everyone. In addition to going to the website, to the link, you'll see it in the newsletter. The Flip Workshop registration page is now open for all of the 10 workshops that we'll be doing around the state. So be sure and get your name in before they fill up. Thank you all very much. If you have any questions, we'll be on air for a little bit longer if you have anything that you want to ask or you want to share. Thank you all.